solidarity forever.
We are singing
solidarity forever. Solidarity for Buhari. I am Tobago Funsu. Forever, we shall always fight for our rights.
Aluta,
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 Victoria,
Asanta,
Sara, Soke.
We have a press conference here, and the stress is about the issue of this security in the country. The misgovernance as typified by the president himself, and of course the industrial rest that we are having in the country. As for Nigerian security situation, I think it's starting from Aso Rock. The leadership of the country is almost paralyzed. We have more of the presidency than an active president. As you know, the president is gone for some days now, which to the UK for a short rest. A short, you know, when tall men make short rest, it tends to be long, you know, tend to be long rest. In this case, the president does not have a recent history of active participation in his own government. And that means the ministers can do anything. There's not enough supervision, adequate supervision of the country as it were. And that's not good enough. And we want to see whether by April 14, when 21 days we have lapsed, whether we have come, or whether we have come back, whether it was constitutional stipulation or not, because he didn't transmit power before he left. It's then that we hear that he wants to participate in the burial of the Duke of Edinburgh. That's the husband of the Queen of England. Where we are wondering and waiting, and we are saying Nigerians should demand better accountability for this man who came on the platform of change but has not changed anything. Now, our press conference also touched on the issue of the industrial arrest. The protests of the workers in the courts, in the judiciary. Judiciary Staff Union of Nigeria has been on the strike for about 8 days now, 9 days. And there's no end in sight, and they are protesting for the absence of the financial autonomy as guaranteed by government, by the constitution, and as guaranteed by court order of 2014, which the governors of these various states have not obeyed. They are not keeping to the constitution, and the workers say no, enough is enough. You are affecting judiciary. They are not independent. They are appendages, and this is not a situation cognizable under the constitution. And we support them, and we are asking the NBA to support them fully and not to whittle down the influence of that strike. The polytechnic workers, to lecturers, they are on strike too. In fact, the education sector, like many other sectors, is in a rut. Again, we support these workers. As for the insecurity, it's palpable all over the country and getting worse by the day under the Buhari regime. Look, Nigerians must rise to the occasion. Clearly, this government and their types are not responsible people. They don't even have a clue how to run a government. And that is why we are having this this problem. We are asking Nigerians to agitate on all fronts, to arouse this government into action and to change them. Not just anybody that we don't want PDP, we put APC, we don't want APC, we want PDP. No, people who will actually make all of us to achieve the status and enjoy the status of a citizen, and not just people who are there to feather their own nest. This is what we talk about, police brutality also in our something that is still on. Police brutality is still on. Despite the NSAS protest, the police, they are like leopard. They are finding it difficult to share their spots, and they still brutalize many people. The case of Mr. Tunde Abbas is a point, it's a case in point, and we are going to court in respect of that. This is just about generally why we call this press conference today, to sensitize Nigerians about their civic responsibility, not to continue to accept docilely the irresponsibility of government.
The press conference dwelt majorly on the failure of the President Muhammadu Buhari-led regime to offer qualitative health care for the majority of Nigerians. As we speak, President Muhammadu Buhari is in a private hospital in London, in the United Kingdom. This private treatment is taking place at the background of a just recently suspended strike action by the National Association of Resident Doctors. And the demands of the doctors, striking doctors at that time, the strike, as we are now aware, was suspended for 4 weeks. And the demands of that strike, puts a question mark on the state of healthcare in Nigeria. So what the President Muhammadu Buhari-led regime is trying to tell us is that he can treat himself at the taxpayers' expense in a private London hospital, while the majority of Nigerians can rot away and can even die away in the homeland. And also, we also raise the question of the U.S. reports. We are opposed to that U.S. report. The report is prejudicial. It states on one hand that it awaits the outcome of the panel, that the Lagos State Judicial Panel on inquiry on salary abuses and other matters, while at the same time it has already taken a position. We are opposed to that report. And in any event, there's an introduction of SARS by another name, and that is SWAT. These SWATs have not been deployed to Tennessee State Police Command. We are opposed to this reintroduction without any comprehensive police reforms. On the whole, we give our solidarity to all the striking trade unions. That is the Judiciary Tribunal of Nigeria, who is struggling for a genuine cause, the independence of the judiciary, and also the Academic Staff Union of Polytechnics. As we are now aware, the Maritime Staff Union of Nigeria has given a 7-day notice of strike. We welcome all these strikes. We call for solidarity of workers, of oppressed people, of young people in a struggle to throw off this barbaric capitalist system and enthrone an egalitarian society wherein the elements of society can be galvanized for education, for health care, for all forms of people's services.
Well, I think Buhari traveling abroad for his own health at a time where the health of majority of his 200 million citizens is in jeopardy shows that the lives of African people, not only Nigerian people in general, is not the priority of any African government. I always say to people, like, as citizens of our country, it seems like the job of our government is to prove that we are not citizens, to dehumanize us. You understand? So there's a year now into COVID pandemic all over the world. I'm sure maybe Nigeria is the only country, including poor countries, that did not build one new hospital. Not even one new clinic was delivered to the people of this country. That is state of the art. But look at pandemics in the world, we've given you this new clinic to at least, they are building tents and so. I mean, it just shows that they are highly detached from the situation of Nigerian people. Governance in Africa, not only in Nigeria, but Nigeria especially, is about preserving the interest of a minute few. And as long as those people's interests are met, and they can disseminate some cash to their boys, you know, because I wish people, like, we are animals to our governments, you know, they treat us like animals. So the only animals that human beings are allowed to come close to them are their pets. So these are our government, they have their pets. So as long as they take care of those pets, take care of themselves, they believe that they've done anything that Nigeria needs, everything is done, you know. So that's what I see here. I think his action is just a reaffirmation of the dehumanizing agent that rules us as a government here in Nigeria, you know.
The New Nigeria Network is a coalition of civil society activists. It's an organization that was built out of the NSAS revolt. And today we are here to discuss about police brutality, about the state of insecurity in Nigeria, and the socio-economic crisis that is bedeviling the country today. All of these positions, we are here to see and put them in proper perspectives, placing on the tables our own political cards of the fact that Nigeria today is a country of war and what, which is not what we want. What we want is a country that will care about the health welfare of the people, that will care about the education welfare of the people, that will care about the employment welfare of the people. We want a country today that the security of everybody becomes very palatable to them. We had a situation when there was mass insecurity in the country. The first family in the country ran away to Dubai, led by the first lady. Today, when we had a health crisis in the country, the president of the country ran to London. We don't want such situations again. And that is why we are calling immediately for the resignation of the president of the country. We are saying that Buhari should go. And go not alone, but with the system of greed and power that is imposing in the country, with the divisive circumstances that is putting the country in, he should go with the mass of insecurity that is putting the country in today. That is why we are here to have this press conference. That is why we are speaking to the world and telling the world that we support the Buhari Must Go agitation that is going on massively in London. We are calling for all Nigerians in London and all lovers of political change to come out and harass and chase away President Buhari away from London so that he can come back to Nigeria and enjoy the bad health care and the health crisis that we are speaking to.
We are here today to express our complete dissatisfaction and disapproval as regards the state of the country. And I think we do not need too many words and too many analyses to begin to prove how terrible and extremely backward the country is today. And we can easily start with the recent burning issue and conversations about the president of the president of a country, not just any country, the most populous black nation, the most popular black nation in this country, traveled out of Nigeria to a UK hospital there to go seek medical care. At the time, Nigerian doctors have gone on strike. At the time, the government has consciously refused to fund our health sector. And the mere fact that President Buhari decidedly left the country to go seek medical care abroad is that it has himself by that action admitted that the state of health in Nigeria is not only worse, but that also our hospitals are only capable of dishing out death sentences and not saving lives. And that is why some of us will be first instances this medium to commend the opposition and the protest of the Nigerian people, especially in the UK, that have been demanding for over a week that the president of the country returns back to the country to seek medical care in the so-called world-class hospital he has built in Nigeria. And probably when we all begin to face this, Nigerian leaders will see reason to begin to ensure that hospitals are well-funded, even in we saw a deputy governor. We saw a deputy governor in Kogi State who could not even matriculate his own daughter in a Kogi State University. No see, even my case without in a single public institution in Kogi. And meanwhile, this same government has refused to pay workers for months. It has completely abandoned the project of funding public education, paying salaries, and public infrastructure. But unfortunately, they have the time to deal two activists. They have the time and the net to deal two activists who were nearly protesting the bad system we currently operate. We see a country that is surrounded by insecurity that has completely engulfed the entire, that has completely engulfed the entire nation. Recently, we saw a situation, a very terrible tradition of impunity by the Nigerian army when they mobilized themselves down to a community in Benue State and killed most of them, razed several houses. These are levels of impunity that depict what some of what the Endsars protests represent. This kind of killings were much more similar, probably in a much more monstrous dimension, to what actually happened to peaceful protesters, for instance, on October 10th. What we see here is a trend of lawlessness, class ineptitude, and complete impunity, lack of respect for life and rule of law. That has been displayed by security agents, by Nigerian military in Benue State. And coming of it, there has been several agitation by different sections of Nigerian people, like these persons, like persons from the Dubuwa Republic and the young people of Biafra, who for a very long time have been clamoring secession in Nigeria. And you will not blame individuals or persons who have begun agitating that, look, Nigeria must break. It all stems to a conclusion or to an analysis that the country is practically not working for anybody and everybody. And you can test that by simply asking probably a ship from Canada to simply come to Nigeria and say it's intended to convey Nigerians out of Nigeria the next 24 hours. Believe you me, the next 24 hours, if you find a single person remaining in Nigeria, probably it's going to be member people who occupying and who have been looking the country. And even some of them will in fact leave the country because they have not even built hospitals that can treat them when they are sick. They have not built schools that can teach their children. So these are some of the abnormal situations that we are faced with. But for some of us, what we say is not about the visibility or invisibility of Nigeria. It is also on two perspectives. That one, the problem of Nigeria has very little or nothing particularly to do with the ethnic group of persons who are leading this country. In the Southwest, for instance, the first group of persons who are responsible for the welfare of Southwest people are their leaders, the governors, the House of Rep members, the House of Assembly members, local government chairman. We can see how much these people have ruled and governed this country only to the interest of their friends and cronies, and have paralyzed millions of people across the Southwest. And you can see even when Southern governors like Obasanjo was in power, Southern president like Obasanjo was president, he could even barely construct a decent road in his hometown, Ota, let alone guarantee decent government for the Nigerian people. Even a Jonathan has a very terrible, has a very good track record, even in his hometown. So these are some of the situations we are forced with. And look at the so-called popularized agenda, that there's a Fulanization agenda. Yes, why the body language of the Nigerian president definitely shows a trend that favors a particular ethnic group over another. But some of us need to assert that even the so-called Fulanization agenda has only benefited President Buhari's powerful friends and cronies who are Fulanis, and some of who are even some of our southern friends here. There are over 10 million Fulanis in this country. How many of them have access to jobs? How many of them can go to school? That's the situation we are forced with. And there's also a different perspective to see this, that even if we must go by the way of secession, we must in the first instance chase out a government that will find it difficult to respect our right to freedom of speech and expression.
It is our considered opinion that President Buhari's incessant foreign medical tourism within the context of a national health sector that has been neglected for so long is, to say the least, condemnable. Because right now, doctors are once again are going on strike to protest the fact that their basic entitlements as medical workers have not been paid, and also because of the historic underfunding of the health sector over the years by both the federal and state government, which has resulted into mass exodus of medical doctors that have been expensively trained by Nigeria. So for our president to continue to resort to foreign medical treatment, which actually is what all members of the ruling elite do, is something that all Nigerians should be worried about. I think it's time that all Nigerians should begin to ask serious questions about a situation where just about 500 people, according to widely reported surveys, just about 500 super rich Nigerians spend over $1 billion every year on medical tourism, while the rest of us, over 200 million Nigerians, have no hospitals to go to when we fall sick. And that's why the doctors are always on strike. So this situation is absolutely condemnable. It is enough reasons for all Nigerians to wake up and begin to demand for their right to health care. We subscribe to the point of view that healthcare is a basic human right. It's not a luxury. Healthcare is what all Nigerians should be entitled to. So, we're at a situation where only very few privileged politicians can afford healthcare by traveling out of the country, can no longer be tolerated. I think it's also time for Nigerians to demand that whoever wants to be our president, whoever wants to be our governor, whoever wants to be our local government chairman, and cannot attend our local hospitals when he or she falls sick, should not step forward for public office contestation anymore. I think it's time that Nigerians should begin to put some of these conditions in place. If our schools are not good enough for your children to attend, if your children must travel abroad for education, then you have no business being a leader at any level in Nigeria. If our hospitals are not good enough for you, then you have no business contending for any election in Nigeria. I think until we get to that stage, we will not see any radical improvement in the state of our healthcare and other basic services such as public education, which have all been neglected over the years and which have all fallen into absolute state of disrepair, which has resulted into all sorts of social maladies. We now have situations, for instance, in places like Lagos State, where state schools have become grooming grounds for thugs because these schools are overpopulated. We have situations where over 120 children, 200 children, 300 children are being taught in a class, which are resulting to all manner of extremely negative socialization, including drug abuse. This state of affairs can no longer be tolerated. That politician who cannot send his own children to our public schools have no business running for public office. I think we must get to that point where we must insist on some of these basic standards before we can see rapid improvement in the development of our country.
Thank you very much.